This class we are going to study about phylogeny. Phylogeny means how to draw a phylogeny tree from the available data that can be read by this particular phylogeny. So the objectives of this phylogeny is basis of phylogeny tree and how phylogeny trees are constructed and how phylogenies can address questions about evolution. So this phylogeny is actually the important thing which all must know, the evolution of different species from different sources, like evolution of man starts from chimpanzee and so on. So reptiles and different organisms are different animals and its phylogenic trees, that is very important. So that is the basics of this phylogenic tree and how they are constructed. This tree is very much useful in identifying the similarities. Based upon the tree construction, we find the homology of the particular the species which is sequenced, and the sequence are blasted, and the blasted sequence are identified by the homology using this phylogenetic tree analysis. So phylogeny is actually, the phylogenetics is the study of ancestor descent relationship. The objective of phylogenetics is to construct phylogenes, and the phylogeny is actually a hypothesis of ancestor descent relationship, and phylogenetic tree is actually a graphical summary of phylogeny. So then what is phylogeny? All life forms are related by common ancestors and descents. The construction of phylogenies provides explanation of the diversity seen in the natural world. Okay. The phylogenies can be based on the molecular morphological data, phylogenetic data, molecular data, or all three. So all three means it may be a morphology, or maybe a physical, maybe a molecule. Okay. So today's phylogenies are usually constructed using DNA sequence data. So this these data, like DNA sequence data, you can construct the phylogeny, and from the phylogeny you can identify the given species. Okay. So this is actually different trees which are named as phylogenetic trees. It may be a sister tax, or it may be can see here different thing. One is actually this is actually branched one, branched chain. This is this is a common ancestor. This is a branched one. We call them as taxon 1 or taxon 2, and taxon 3 actually the taxon. It has same characters of taxon 2, but different characters seen in taxon 3 and taxon 4 and taxon 5, and taxon 6. So these are nodes, and these are the roots from which a particular phylogenetic tree is appears. This is the tip. These are the tips or terminal nodes of the different organism. These two taxon 2 and taxon 3 are sister taxons, because they belong to the same nodes. Okay, this is a type of phylogenetic tree. Okay, then coming to this B, actually B, we have phylogenetic tree like this is one way of expressing a phylogenetic tree, and this is the other way of expressing phylogenetic tree, and this is the other way. So this is one. So depends upon the relationship between the characteristics of the individual organism, we can form this particular phylogeny. For example, here it's the same. It's the case of here you can see it's a common common root. This is a common root, and followed by the nodes. So you can see the common characteristics of B, C, D, and E, which has actually common notes. having same rajas, right? This is the thing. And as far as this is concerned, we have the analysis are like this. Okay, this is the different type of trees. Which one? So phylogenetic, what are phylogenetic characters? So we use characters to construct phylogenies. A character is any attribute of an organism that can provide us with insights into history. So that is the sharing ancestors, right? In molecular phylogenies, the characters are typically nucleotide position in a gene sequence. Each position can be possess four characters like A, C, T, and G. So these four characters represents the molecular phylogenic tree analysis. Okay, these characters are typically nucleotide position. So what are the characters? A character is an attribute of an organism that can provide us with insights into the history, that is shared the ancestor part. Okay, so coming to the cladistic characters state definition, like there are many number of character defines definition. Some is pleomorphic, that refers to the ancestral character state. Some are apomorphic, characters state difference than the ancestral state or derived state. Some are synapomorphy, a derived character state of apomorphy that shared by two or more taxa due to inheritance from a common ancestor. These characters states are phylogenetically informative using the parsimony or Clasidium cretineae. So then another thing is it is a octopomorphy, a unique derived character state. So these are the different character states of different thing, like apomorphy, lysiomorphy, octopomorphy, synapomorphy, and homoplasy by varying the characters of this thing, we can have our phylogenetic trees. So coming to other definitions, like what is monophyletic, non-monophyletic, paraphyletic, and polyphyletic. So monophyletic is a group that includes all the descendants of common ancestors, like monophyletic groups are also called clades. And non-monophyletic is a any case that does not satisfy the group, such as actually paraphyletic and polyphyletic. So paraphyletic is a group that indicates includes some but not all of the descendants of common ancestors. And polyphyletic assemblies of taxa that have aggressive group on the basis of homoplastic characters, example vultures. So this is a monophyletic groups. We have all groups circled in reds are monophyletic. Monophyletic means actually a group that includes all the descendants of common ancestors. Okay. Generally they call us clades. So this is an example of monophyletic. Synapomorphs identify monophyletic groups which have same ancestors, like the lungs of a fish, or limb of a frog, or amniotic eggs, hollow shells of turtles, and extensive changes in skeleton of lizards, and hollow skulls in front of eye sockets in the case of crocodiles, and S-shaped neck, short foam limb feathers in the case of birds. So actually these are the examples of some of the monophyletic groups which are of same ancestors, right? It may be a lungfish, or it may be a frogs, or it may be mammals, or turtles, snakes, crocodile, and birds. So that's the thing. So here the reptiles. This is a monophyly and non-monophyly. So monophyletic is actually, we have seen the common ancestor here and the branch thing in the two directions, and we have a branch here also, right? So, and a non-monophyletic is actually, we have these two things which are not, which are evolved in different things. Okay, so here is a paraphyletic and polyphyletic. For reptiles, we have the common characters in the case of birds, crocodiles, lizards, and turtles. And polyphyletic, the same as the vultures. The vultures are of different types. The common ancestors, like they may be old world vultures, or bird of prey, or stork and relatives, and new world of vultures. Then as far as reptiles are concerned, they are the paraphyletic group, which are actually named based on the past data and present data. Okay. So as far as the past data is concerned, we can name as turtles, we can name as turtle. The past data, we just name turtles, crocodiles, and snakes as reptiles, and birds and mammals. Now we have birds, crocodiles, snakes, and turtles as Sida. So it's a group which is actually based on new characters, name based on current data. Okay, so mammals are different. So the paraphyletic is a group that contains some but not all descendants of common ancestors. Then what is homology and homoplasy? Homology is actually the characters that are shared between two DNA sequence or taxa, maybe so because they inherited it from a common ancestors or homologous. So homologous they are called synapomorphy. They are actually defined as a characters state that it is shared between two DNA sequence or taxonomy, maybe so because they are inherited it from a common ancestors, or it is homology. Okay, alternatively, the shared characters might occur because they were evolved independently, in which case they are homoplasy. So this is the difference between the homology and homologous and homoplasy. So here the characters might occur independently, they maybe come from the common ancestors. This is homology occurs is actually they can be of a parallel evolution, or they can be a converge evolution, or they can be of secondary laws, right? So as far as parallel evolution is concerned, it's independent evolution of same features from same ancestor condition. So this denotes the same evolution of same features from same ancestral conditions, whereas in convergent evolution, the independent evolution of same features from different ancestors. These are the same features, but it is originated from the different ancestral conditions. And secondary laws is a revision of the ancestral condition. This is actually revision of the ancestral condition. The same characters is revised, shown here. So this is the secondary laws. So this is how homoplasy occurs, right? Then homoplasy and polyphyly. I told you homoplasy for the example maybe it's a polyphyletic grouping such as vultures. So we just call it polyphyly vultures. It may be a new vulture, or maybe an old one, or maybe stork relatives and bird of prey, something like that. It's a vulture. These vultures are a polyphyletic group, a new world and old world vultures provides an example of homoplasy resulting from convergent evolution. So the eyes. So these for convergence, actually convergence evolution, actually I told you that it may be the independent evolution of same features from different ancestors. So here you can see here these are from different ancestors. It's a fish. This is an octopus. This is a crocodile. So the position of the eyes is similar state. So it has a ball, it has a lobe, like, and the same eye features. eye features in the case of octopus or ray-finned fish, crocodiles and hippopotamus. So coming to non-homologous, they call us analogy. So they are also called as homology. The fins of whales and fins of shark are another example of homoplasy. Due to the convergence, the independent acquisition of the characters in the different linkage. This is, I mean, the whales is actually a mammal and the shark is a fish. So the convergence are, I mean, of different linkage, but it is a homoplasy. Then three spine stacks blacks. So the same type of fish but different thing. Three spine stackle back species paired have independently and coastal lake of British Columbia. And passive asset mating, disturbing selection have been importance of divergence of this pair. This is actually deals with the DNA sequencing. There is reversible, reversal and phylogeny. There are two. One is mutation can create synomorphs, like the DNA sequence is distance. Here you can see, the mutation of A forms T, I. This is a mutation occurs here. So this is, the ancestral DNA is here, and the formed DNA has some difference that can be called a synomorphy. So this is the example for it. This is the reversal. Then construction of phylogenetic tree, we use homologous characters or synapomorphs to construct phylogenetic trees and to identify groups that are monophyletic. Synapomorphies are phylogenetic informative. We want to avoid using homologous characters to construct the phylogeny. So this is actually the two thing. It's called homology and homoplasy reverted. It may be this particular thing has been from single ancestor nodes. So here this is a homology and this is a homoplasy. This is the difference between these two. So what is parsimony? It's actually also called as clinicities. The principle of parsimony, a simple explanation are preferred over more complicated ones. In the term phylogenetic tree, less evolutionary steps are better than more steps to explain relationship. The tree with the least number of steps is the most parsimonious. The parsimony methods minimize the total number of evolutionary changes required to explain the relationship. So here you can see the parsimony of actually evolution of eyes. So this is the origin of camera eyes, where we it's the origin here you can see this is actually one type of origin of camera eye. Here you can see a loss in the subrotatory pairs in the flare forms. Here you can see both are of same origin, but here's a loss of the eyes. So here in the case there's a gain of camera eyes in the case of fish vertebrates and molluscs. So in the case of rotifers, platforms and segmented worms, echinoderms, the arthropods and roundworms, the camera eye origin is losses. Here is a gain in the case of molluscans and vertebrates. So constructing the tree with parsimony is thing is that when considering a phylogeny for a group of organisms, we need to employ an outgroup which is not part of the group of interest. So the in group, but also not too distinct related to it. The outgroup is used to polarize the character states or infer changes. The character states process by the outgroup is called as ancestral thing. Then we call as leosomorphic. So evolution actually it's a amblyopes or it's a thing. It's a, actually the it's a, I mean crocodile-like compounds from this. This is a mammal. from this the crocodile from this the thing the whales is evaluated. So whale is the so what is Artiodactyly? The Artiodactyly, a group of hoped mammal that possess an even number of toes, including camels, pigs, passes, deer, hippopotamus, cattle, giraffe. The Perseodactyly actually are a hoofed animal that possess odd number of toes. Here, even number has odd number of toes like horses, rhinos, and tapirs. So, are whales really a member of Arctodactyly? Here is, I mean, selecting the phylogenetry with parsimony, like with the thing actually the whales are really a member of Arctodactyly, a hoofed mammals. So here again, in early stage, it may be a whale earlier or whale later. Here, parsimony, as if you using morphology of a dog or the structure of dogs or the the toes or the so depending upon the molecular characters of micro characters, the parsimony can be used. It may be site 142 is plesiomorphy as uniform informative. Site 192 is octomorphy, it's uniformative. Site 162, 166, and 167 are synomorphy. So this is actually based on the sequence we can actually analyze the phylogenetry for parsimony. So what about the informative sites tells us about whale phylogeny? Site 162, 166 conflicts with 177. Hence, they are homoplasy in data sets. Whale ELA is 47 NT change, whereas late is 41. Assessing confidence in phylogeny, we have the methods called as bootstrap method. It's a bootstrap method, it's a computational technique for estimating the confidence level of phylogenetic hypothesis. Randomly generated new data sets from old data. 1,000 reptiles are most common. Computing the number of times that are particular groups that appeared in the tree or branched. Then phylogeny and actually very, very well linked with the taxonomy. Taxonomy group can be monophyletic, polyphyletic. Monophyletic contains all descendants of common ancestors. Paraphyletic contains some not all descendants of common ancestors or polyphyletic. The goal of cladistic taxonomy is to only recognize monophyletic groups as valid taxa, but traditional taxonomy has not always done this. So cladistic, the use of the paraphyletic construct, evolution relationship, that's the thing. So based upon the taxonomy, three domains of life: archaea, bacteria, and eukarya. Eukaryotes are actually further divided into super kingdoms, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species, which we have seen when we study. Super group is Unicota, kingdom is Animalia, phylum is Chordata, class is Mammalia, and order is Primata, and family is Homo genetae, genus Homo sapiens, species Homo. This is human taxonomy is there. So example of example the animate, what is Animota? Animota is actually the super kingdom we called us. So all amniotic eggs possess several membranes like amnion, carrion, and allantois that protects developing embryo. This amniotic eggs was an important evolutionary innovation and adaptation for life on lands and protect the development of embryo from desiccation. Then paraphyletic, paraphyletic groups, many taxonomic groups that were recognized by traditional taxonomy or paraphyletic, example fish, So the fish, may, I mean, this is the thing, it was took from Phocaeus concern, common ancestor, bacteria, archaea, and the eukarya, where common ancestor outbreaks, old living angiosperms, and clady related megalons, monads, eukaryotes, and fish of different kinds, common ancestors, maybe a shark, or sedgewans, or some pest base, or fish, low-find fish, amphibians. So these are the things which is called as paraphyletic groups. And using phylogeny, we can actually differentiate this chameleon. This is called as biogeography. Biogeography is a branch of science that seeks explanation for why organisms are found in some region but not other. This very often involves the use of phylogenetics to test hypothesis concern the geographic origin of different species or group of species such as the chameleon. Phylogenetics, the chameleon in different different ages and different cities and different countries, it may differ according to but the same origin, but different countries have different type of chameleon. Using this phylogeny, you can identify different types and different place it lives. So in the case of South Africa or Antarctica, Africa, Madagascar, India, and Australia. So we may see that it is lived in 170 million years ago, or 140 million years ago, or 110 million years ago. So using phylogenetics, we can actually predict the coevolution. Coevolution is actually the process where evolutionary changes in the traits of one species derives evolutionary changes in the traits of another. Coevolution can involve the predator and prey, host, parasite, and mutualism, such as hadrosaurs and their endosymbiotic bacteria. The coevolution can result in co-specifications also. So this is actually phylogenetic and co-evolution chart, where you can see symbiotic bacteria relation, like it could be aphids. It's a relation of nodes in bacterial tree to nodes in amphibic trees. So these are the two things which links phylogeny and coevolution. So other phylogenetic methods the method of parsimony, cladis in phylogenetic reconstruction. However, other more powerful methods are available for use with DNA sequence data. These are collectively referred to as frequent probability methods, includes maximum likelihood, the Bayesian methods of phylogenetic inference. They are computational intensive and have only been frequent using past 12 years when computer become more powerful to accommodate them. So to summarize phylogeny, actually we must use characters that are homologous and avoid homoplastic in phylogeny constructions. Parsimony seeks the simplest explanation that requires the least amount of changes. Phylogenetic constructions is a powerful tool that can be used to answer many evolutionary questions. So that's it. That is the phylogeny, and how do you do the phylogenetic construction, and how you will construct a phylogeny. So we have a software, this is called MIX software. So I will in the next coming classes I will just project the MIX software, how to construct a phylogeny tree and what are the analysis based on the phylogeny tree analysis. Thank you. Thank you, Pandian.
Sir, thank you very much, sir.